This is the 2011 Football Officials Aloha Clinic training tape on personal fouls. There's a lot of different kinds of personal fouls, some of them easy, some of them a little bit more judgmental. We're going to start out with the horse collar. Most of this has been corrected over the course of the last couple of years. But this first play was called a horse collar, and I think that this probably is one that we can pass on. He does get the collar, but it's a ride forward tackle. But he doesn't really yank him back, and he rides him through the tackle.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Play number two was called a horse collar, and by definition, you could probably categorize it that way. But this is just one of those that's real, real tight, and you could probably pass. It got called by a deep official. This was a seven-man, but the back judge probably could have helped. He does have the side of the collar, and the side of the collar or shoulder pad or shoulder pad in the back is part of the definition. And he does tackle him by the side of the collar, but he pulls him forward with it. So if we want to try to lay off of one, this is right there in that gray area where we want to do it. But it was called, and by definition, supportable.
Play.
Personal foul, illegal horse collar tackle on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run.
That's a big
one. Is a first down.
That is a...
Plays number three and play number four are both horse collar tackles. They are from a previous year because, like I said, most of these horse collar tackles have been cleaned up. So you can see he grabs them by the back of the horse collar, utilizes that to pull him backwards, buckling the hip and knees. That's the safety factor, so that's a great call. This one was affected by a rule change because it starts right about the time he goes out of bounds and carries on, and this is now considered a live ball foul. So even though the player's out of bounds when the act occurs, it's enforced as a live ball. Plays 5 and 6 are examples of hurdling, illegal hurdling in high school. In the college game, you see it periodically out of the runner, and it's legal for the runner to hurdle in college. But in high school, it's a penalty for the runner or anybody else to hurdle. So we've got a good example of it here, and we'll have a good example of it on the next play. And these are just plays for you guys to look at so you can recognize when you see it on the field of play so it doesn't turn out to be a big surprise. I'll put the sound on the next one.
It'll be second and 11 after a gain of four, after the initial penalty. Once again, running with the football, looking for some space. Oh, what a great leap. He loses the football, though. It's loose on the field, and it looks...
A football player, watch him run the ball and take this hurdle right at the end, but the ball slips loose midair, and Pac-5 recovers.
You can see the referee in the background. He spots this. He throws the flag. Ultimately, it was declined because of the change of possession, but it's a nice job of picking that up. Plays number 7 through 10 are pile pickers, and we've been putting pile pickers in these videos through the scrimmage kicks, the free kicks. They're all over the place, and we really need to focus on getting this. Back judge, you're the perimeter guy in this area, so you have to watch these guys when they come in. That's a personal foul, and we got to pick it up. Also, when you look at it from this zone, it's a good no-call for face mask because it is just a wrap-over, spin-off, then the ball becomes loose. So, nice job for not calling the face mask, but we do need to get that pile picker. Play number 8, we've got another pile picker. I think this is a quarterback sack. No, running back stuff. But I'm going to highlight the player here, 49. Play's over. So 49 or 48, whatever that is, he's just going to get cracked in the back. Now, line of scrimmage guy, maybe the referee, back judge for sure, possibly umpire. This was picked up. Nice job, but those are the things we've got to watch for in our dead ball action. Play number 9, this one actually comes a little bit from behind the play. You can see the guy come in late and just cream a guy. Here's the angle, so we've got to get a perimeter guy, line of scrimmage guy, or back judge. Got to pick this up.
After the play, personal foul, late hit on the offense. 15-yard penalty. We reset the chains. First down.
Play number 10 is the last of our pile pickers in this section, and this one's a little different because it's toward the end of the run. It's a long run for a touchdown, and then number 27 here just gets crazy and decides to pick somebody off of the back as his runner is, or receiver, is crossing the goal line. This was picked up by the umpire, proper mechanic for the umpire, because you can see his hat here at the bottom. He's following and trailing that play and that section of the play. The referee's a little bit further behind him. So that's a nice pickup. Philosophy is that if the runner is close to the goal line, when this action occurs, watch 44 Blue, he's the one that gets it, then it's a score. If this action occurs where the running back is clearly in the field of play or short of the goal line, you're going to pull the score. Plays 11 through 14, we're going to cover face masks. Now this was called a 5-yard face mask. I'm not a big fan of the 5-yard face mask because it just says hand on, fingers curled in, without any pull. But generally speaking, if you get hand on and fingers in, there's going to be some kind of pull. So the default call on face mask is 15. If you see the hand in there at all, this is clearly a 15-yard face mask. But if you see the hand in there at all, it just slides off, you might not have anything. But if you get the fingers in there and any kind of tug whatsoever, then you've got a 15-yard face mask foul. Here's another one. Looks like everybody on the field's got it, so nobody's watching blockers. But that was clearly a face mask call. It's right up the middle. Referee calls it, line judge calls it, umpire calls it, and clearly it's there.
I got a personal foul, face mask on the defense.
Play number 13, this is a face mask major that's called by the head linesman. When I say face mask major, I mean face mask 15 yarder. He had a very difficult angle to see this, but I think at the very end of it, because it was such a prolonged face mask, he got that back end with the hand pulling the head over. So good pickup by the head linesman. Might have been able to get this from the back judge as well. Play 14. 15-yarder was called. It's very difficult to see because I've only got one angle here, and it was real quick. So I'm not sure if there was or wasn't. Doesn't matter. I've got this play in here for the announcement.
Personal foul, face mask on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. By rule, the quarter cannot end on an accepted live ball penalty. Therefore, we'll have an untimed down.
The next 7 or 8 plays are going to be plays relating to hits out of bounds or near the sideline. So we're going to start out with the quarterback rolling out, throwing a pass down the field, and then a guy just getting shoved out of bounds. This was called a late hit out of bounds, correctly so. I think this is a very easy call to make. I'd like to see it called 100% of the time.
After the play, personal foul, late hit out of bounds on the defense, half the distance to the goal, first down.
Play number 16. This was a hit out of bounds, and it occurred at knee level, which I'm particularly sensitive to. I just don't like those knee level hits out of bounds. In this case, they did call a foul for a late hit out of bounds, and I like it. If he goes down low, down the sideline, yeah, we're clean. But as this quarterback veers out, and he follows that red line, he's targeting an out of bounds spot. That's a nice pickup.
Personal foul on the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Results in the first down.
Play number 17. This was called a late hit out of bounds, but I really believe this is more of just continuing action. You'll see that there's two players involved in the action near the sideline, and that it does carry considerably far out of bounds, which is a consideration. I know our radar goes up at that point. But watch as these guys get together. We have one guy holding him, still in bounds. Second guy pushes him and disengages, and the other guy falls backwards. To me, this does not meet the criteria for a personal foul late hit.
Over a personal foul on the defense. 15th penalty. First down.
I think that's one of the things that...
Here's another interesting point. You can see the referee, he's gathering his thoughts. What's the status of the clock? Guys, you got to be ready to provide that information after every penalty. Play number 18, another late hit out of bounds. This is the quarterback, he runs out, and the contact does not seem severe, but the contact is completely unnecessary, and it's on the defense to avoid contact if it's clear that the play is over. and it's clear he didn't need to push him. Besides that, anytime a cheerleader almost gets hurt, it's almost assuredly a personal foul. Play 19, hit out of bounds. The back judge does a great job of picking up this action out of bounds. It's not a body hit, it's like a punch. But the head linesman is not watching the out-of-bounds action. We talk about that time and time again. You see the scuffle, back judge comes in and gets it, says, number two, you're a bad guy. So, head linesman, when this guy's out-of-bounds, you have to visually follow him. You're still working. Back judge saved you on that one. Number 20, out-of-bounds play. This is a pull down out of bounds. It's a real late action. Doesn't seem like much, but when you watch the replay, you'll see that it was unnecessary and an excellent call for a dead ball personal foul. That's completely unnecessary.
After the play, personal foul, late hit out of bounds on the defense, 15-yard penalty, results in a first down.
Play 21 is referred to as a tightrope, and that is if the running back is tightroping the sideline and it's not apparent that he's out of bounds, there is some allowable contact that you would otherwise call a dead ball personal foul. 2, 3, 4 steps, he's out of bounds, but the defense doesn't know it because he's right there on the sideline, so that's a good no call. Play number 22, out of bounds, late hit, so let's take a look at this one. Just sandwiched him. No need for that. You can see in the picture replay, he's way out of bounds. Gives him a sandwich. Good call for a personal foul. 23. Another late hit. Another good call. Pretty easy. Actually, really easy. The announcers had a lot of fun with that.
Yeah, that was a little late.
After the play, personal foul, late hit on the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Play number 24 is actually two plays put together. The first play, you can see the defense come in a little bit late and sandwich the guy. He's just kind of nasty, a little push on the helmet. This is definitely a warning. The very next play, he does the same thing again. And that's when you flag him. If you think that first act is enough to flag, then you flag it. But definitely a warning, and if this happens one play later, you gotta hit that one with a flag. This next section is what I refer to as manageable acts. These plays were called personal fouls on the field, and I think these are some kinds of plays that you can just manage without the flag. What happens is the official anticipates a harder contact, does not follow the play out. Flag's already out of the bag, so we've got a penalty.
After the play was over, personal foul on the defense, the 15-yard penalty, that'll be enough for a first down.
The next manageable act, some of you may not agree with this, and it depends on the game situation. This is pretty early in the game, so I doubt they've had a lot of trouble. But you see some guys get up, there's some pushing, a little bit of shoving, and then you get a flag for personal foul, which was announced as an unsportsmanlike, but it was a personal foul is what was called. So this is the type of play, particularly early in the game, if you haven't had a lot of trouble, that you can get in there in a hurry, talk to these guys, get them straightened out, and let the game flow start to have a rhythm.
So many quarterbacks.
Unsportsmanlike conduct on a defense. Half the distance, first foul.
Play 27, I put this in here because leg whips are getting more and more common, particularly on missed blocks. Now this is a shotgun formation, so we have to be sensitive to low blocks anyway. When we get to the end zone shot of this, you can see number 65. There's only one down lineman rusher, that's the nose guard, so umpire, you are focused right there. As soon as that right guard goes down, you know he's suspect, gets the leg up, whips it across the waist. That is a personal foul, and it needs to be picked up. And that was a good play to pick it up on because the formation allowed for you to see it. Play number 18 had four dead ball personal fouls. And I bring this up because sometimes when you get into dead ball fouls, you get into order of occurrence and half the distance to the goal line. And that's okay if you've got one or two, maybe three. But when you start getting to three, four, five dead ball fouls, order of occurrence becomes more and more challenging to determine. So if you run into that situation, unless you are 100% sure, if you've got equal dead ball penalties against each team, when you make your announcement, just announce that the penalty distances will offset and announce the next down or series of downs if you have a change of possession. I do have to give this referee a lot of credit. They tried to work it out and they tried to get the order of occurrence, and the announcement based on what they determined was very clear and professional.
We have four fouls on the play. First foul is a personal foul against the defense. 15-yard foul. The second foul is a 15-yard foul against the defense. 15-yard foul. The third foul was a personal foul against the offense. 15 yards. And the fourth and final foul was a personal foul against the offense. Half the distance to the goal. It would be White's ball. Third down.
So after all of...
Play 29, possibility for an unsportsmanlike foul. Actually, a distant possibility for two. So, we've got number 21 running with the ball. At this point, he points the ball forward, and this was before his leap, and looks at his pursuer. So that's suspect unsportsmanlike one. I stopped this because I know you'd want to see if he was in or out. Sportsmanship suspect number two is when he does the Rocky celebration in the end zone. It's brief. But sometimes when you combine these, you just decide to go with an unsportsmanlike. I think it was justifiable here. It was not called. But referees, you need to turn with that play so that you can see what's happening and give yourself an opportunity to determine what you need to do with the play. Play number 30 I put in because there were two unsportsmanlike acts called against the running back, and he was ejected on this play. The first was for this action. And that, to me, is not a taunting or unsportsmanlike act. I think you could lay a delay of game on him. But if you did call it unsportsmanlike, when he gets irritated about it and says, that's screwed up, and calls you something, well, that is an unsportsmanlike act. So get amongst yourselves, talk about it, and don't allow this guy to get kicked out on a half-hearted delay of game spike and then being mad about it being a 15-yard penalty when it should have been a 5. Play 31, we do have an unsportsmanlike conduct foul thrown on this play, and I like the fact that it was only one. It's a single act. After he runs out of bounds, big long gainer, fantastic catch. He does his celebration, bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. Then he throws the ball down. Single act, good job by the crew.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense, 15 yards. First down.